Friends, it's Christmas time. Is anybody else as excited as I am about the holiday season? I am so convinced that this Christmas will be the best Christmas ever. And that leads me to a question. What would make this Christmas your best Christmas ever? Think big. No financial limits, no restrictions, no Christmas dream is too big. In fact, I asked some of my friends this exact question. Check out what they said.
So what would make this the best Christmas ever is if I got the opportunity to take my entire family, I'm talking about from my grandparents all the way down to my little nieces and nephews, all the way to Disney. But we took the entire park over, rented it for just ourselves for the entire day, and we got to ride every ride with just me and my family on Christmas Day.
To not only spend all day watching the movie Elf, but to have Buddy the Elf come and hang out with me and my family all day long.
If I got to take my wife, Leslie, on a magic carpet ride like Aladdin, a whole new world.
Is if I could just hang out with my family, hang out with my friends, and that's it, and not have to be 6 feet apart.
You know what would make this the best Christmas ever? Is if I was somehow able to merge the snow and the beach. Think about it. What if you were able to go swimming and then go skiing all in the same day?
If I could have just all the amounts of money to buy all the clothes that I wanted, it would just be amazing. And all the shoes that I wanted. Jordan's especially.
What would make this the best Christmas ever is if I could eat all the baklava in the world. All of my Greek friends, you know what I'm talking about. If you don't know what baklava is, Google it. It's incredible, crispy, sweet, it's nice.
That sounds awesome. I wanna be part of those Christmas celebrations, but let's be real. I can't just listen to my friends dream about their best Christmas ever without telling you about one of my best Christmases ever. A few years ago, one of my best friends in the whole world, literally, came from Ethiopia, where he lives, and spent Christmas with my family in Cleveland, Ohio. Now, if you know anything about Cleveland, Ohio, it's cold in the winter. And so we had snow. We literally had a white Christmas. And it was his first time ever experiencing snow, which was so fun because he's an adult, and so he was able to process out loud all of his thoughts as he was experiencing snow for the first time. He actually said, it's kind of like living in a freezer, which I thought was really funny. Anyways, so my family Christmas, we all love it, and there are tons of competitions. We have coloring competitions, and we have card games, and we have this one competition where, and maybe you do this too, it's a tradition where you like hang a pickle on the Christmas tree somewhere, and everybody, it's like a competition of who can find it first, and then there's a prize. We actually have a prize bin in my family Christmas celebration, where every time you win something, you pick from the prize bin, you know, and there's like candles and socks and back to the Christmas tree. And so there's a pickle on it, and we're telling him, okay, you're gonna look for the pickle on the count of three. Whoever finds it first gets to win a prize. And he's like so excited. And the funniest thing is he leans over to my sister Megan and he taps her and he's like, Meg, what's a pickle? Which is so amazing because he's never had a pickle before. And so then we had to explain what the pickle was, which was so fun. And guess what? He found the pickle, he won! And he gave my whole family lessons in writing Amharic. We actually made like name tags for all of our seats at the Christmas table and they were written in Amharic. Amharic is the most common language spoken in Ethiopia. I wish every Christmas could be like that Christmas. I mean, I love every single celebration, but that one was really special for me. It's kind of fun, right? To think about what we would do if we had complete and total control to make this Christmas the best Christmas ever. Of course, we don't always have complete and total control of the way things work at Christmas. I mean, I feel like that was this entire year, right? I mean, if any of us actually were God, we'd probably make some pretty crazy things happen, right? Maybe you'd make homework go away forever, or maybe you'd take all the cavities out of eating candy. Maybe you would secure a victory for your team every time, no matter the competition. Or maybe you'd make certain that all pets would live forever. How amazing would that be? The reason I think it's so easy for us to come up with this list of things we'd do or not do if we were God is because we all have this idea of what we think God does and doesn't do. We have an idea of how this whole faith thing works. And usually, it falls into one of two categories, good or bad. In other words, we think God will do something for us if we're good, or he'll do something to us if we're bad. If we're good, like if we read our Bible, if we go to church, if we treat people well, then we think God will do good things for us. The more good stuff we do, the more good stuff God does for us in return. That would make God kind of like, well, this thing. Have you ever used one of these gumball machines before? When I was a kid, vending machines were the real deal. I mean, it was the main source of snacks at hockey rinks, hotels, the public swimming pool, bowling alleys, skating rinks. We would find coins in the couch or in our parents' cars and head straight over to the giver of Doritos, Twinkies, or any snack of our choosing. And all we had to do was put a few coins in the machine. I think sometimes we approach God this way, right? We come to him with something good that we do, and we put our good works in, or the good thing that we did, and we hope that God does something in return, or that we get a gumball in return, right? We think like God would reward our good behavior by giving us a prize or a blessing. And maybe for you, that's what you think faith is all about. On the flip side, sometimes we think if we do something bad, that God's gonna be mad at us. Just like he rewards us for the good things that we do, we assume he's going to take away stuff from our lives or punish us or distance himself from us for the bad things that we do. When we think this way, it's kind of like we look at God like an angry adult or something. We think he's just watching and waiting to catch us breaking his rules. And when he does, he'll definitely punish us. Honestly, I don't think either of these things really represent who God is or the way our faith works. Because these ideas of the way God works, they're all about our behavior. In other words, we think our relationship with God is based on our behavior. And I can see why. It's how so many relationships work in our lives. When you do your chores at home, you get an allowance. But when you blow off your chores on purpose, you get grounded. When you do something kind for a friend, they include you in more group hangouts. But when you do something mean, they start leaving you out on purpose. When you do well on your assignments, your teacher gives you an A. When you bomb the test, you get an F. So it makes sense that we would think the same is true for our relationship with God. We think God came to help us or hurt us, and that's pretty much it. Now, I don't know about you, but that doesn't feel like much of anything to celebrate at Christmas. A God who's either for us or against us, depending on how we act, that doesn't sound like the makings of my best Christmas ever. So, what if there was more to it? What if our relationship with God was different than any other relationship in our whole life? What if God sent his son Jesus for more? And if you're asking that question, I did too at one point. And I wanna talk today with you about where I found out more about why God sent Jesus. You see, there was this guy named Matthew, and he wrote down a lot of things a long time ago. And what he wrote down is found in the New Testament of the Bible, which is like the second half or end of the Bible. It's not really half. You see, Matthew lived and walked beside Jesus while he was on earth. So basically, we get to learn from a guy who actually knew Jesus in person, which is pretty cool. To start his book, Matthew gave us a pretty interesting look into how Jesus came into the world. Maybe you've heard this story before, or maybe it's brand new to you today. Either way, listen up because it's pretty epic. Matthew told us that two people, Joseph and Mary, were pledged to be married. That means they were engaged. During their engagement, an angel came down to Mary to tell her that she was pregnant and the child she was carrying was Jesus, the savior of the world. Now, Mary and Joseph, they weren't married yet, and to be pregnant and not married was a huge deal during this time. When Joseph found out about the baby, he planned to break it off with Mary, but he changed his mind after an angel came to him too. And what the angel told Joseph about the baby Mary was carrying can help us understand more about who God really is this Christmas. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Up to this point, people were looking for the Savior. They were looking for the one God had promised would come and save them from their sins. And I think, just like us, they had a lot of different ideas about what he'd be like. Maybe they thought he would come as a king with lots of applause and celebration. Or maybe they thought he would come as a mighty warrior and save them from everyone who was against them. Or maybe they thought he would come riding in on a cloud of smoke or something so glorious that there would be no doubt he was God. But what really happened? God came in a way that nobody expected. He came as a baby to a young, poor couple. No glamour, no celebration, no special attention. Just Jesus quietly coming to earth to save us, to love us, to show us one really important thing that the angel reminded Joseph. God is with us. That's why he came. God came to the world to be with us. And this is so important because up to this point, people saw God a lot like we sometimes do now. Distant, far away, unreachable, only concerned with how we act, there to reward or punish, and that's it. But the promise of Christmas isn't that God came because he wants us to behave a certain way. It's simply that God is with us. He wanted to show us that. And that's a pretty big deal. I think we've all come to understand what it means to be present with someone in a totally different way this year. When the COVID-19 crisis began and we couldn't be with each other, I don't know about you, but it made me realize just how important connection really is. It made me appreciate how important it is to be with someone else. And what's so awesome? That's what God does for us. He's with us, whether you believe in him or not. He's with you. Whether you're doing everything right or everything totally wrong, he's with you. God is with us. He's with me. He's with you. And that's what makes it the best Christmas ever. So, what does all of this have to do with you right now? I think it comes down to three things. First, remember that God is with you. Start with this. For some of you, Christmas is hard. It's anything but merry and bright. It's important to know that God is with you too. He chose to be with you. He's with you when your family's fighting and with you when you're bored at home on break. With you when you're having fun at that ugly sweater Christmas party. With you when you're feeling disappointed because grandma got you another ugly sweater this year. God is with you in all of those moments. And that's worth remembering this year. Next, I want to invite you to spend time with God. In all of this Christmas craziness, make time to spend with God. Read the Bible, pray, listen to music, journal your prayers or thoughts. Separate yourself for even a few minutes a day to spend time with God. After all, that's why he came, to be with you. And last, spend time with other people. God created us to be with other people. All around you, there are people who need you, people who need God. Maybe it's your family, friends, or neighbor, or a classmate. Maybe it's even spending time with the people in your group here at church. Whoever it is for you, make an effort to slow down and be with those people too. Share some of the season with them and help make their Christmas the best Christmas ever. Remember, God is with us. And this Christmas, I think that's the best news ever. As you head out, I want you to think about this question. What's one thing that you're really excited about this Christmas?